Hi everybody, welcome to my channel. This is You Too Can Be Great. Today we are going to be discussing The Real Housewives of Atlanta season 14 episode 5, because she by herself wasn't ready for what Tyrone had to give her. Now the producers who came up with the title "She by Herself" are the most shadiest of them all. Oh my gosh, as I was reading it, I just knew that I was gonna see something that was gonna just hurt my heart. But I will say that this episode was contained with a lot of shade all around. Kenya was shading, Marlo was shading, Kandi was shading, everybody was shading whoever. The only person that didn't know how to shade correctly was Drew, and she always looks confused. So it makes sense that she would not be able to actually articulate herself and be able to shade properly, at least the way that she needs to compete with some of these girls. But this episode was a very well put together. I give it a complete A minus at the bare minimum because I enjoyed it the entire time. So let's get into it. So we start off where it says New York trip night one. This is when they came for the for Kandi's thoughts of a black man. I think that's what the play was called, or is called. And they decided to go to dinner. And during this dinner, Sheree wanted to address Drew coming for her and basically try to use her for a storyline, i.e. this assistant that keeps popping his head up in a camera, trying to get some camera time, trying to get himself on the show, doing everything he can to make sure that he gets his 2 seconds of fame. That assistant, Anthony, has been running around town telling people that Sheree is, you know, who's also known for not paying people, apparently didn't pay him or didn't pay a bunch of people or owes somebody 20K. Whatever he was doing, he was spreading it around that he's Drew's assistant. Drew being delusional and unintelligent in certain areas because she doesn't have good critical thinking skills, which is why Ralph tends to walk all over her and gaslight her all the time. She did not consider the fact that if this man is sitting up here running his mouth about his former supposed boss or whoever he worked with or whoever he was around, chances are if he's running his mouth about her behind her back, he's running his mouth about you to somebody else behind your back. And apparently Sheree was wise enough not to repeat what he was saying because it wasn't something that she had as fact. So while they're having this dinner, since Drew decided to open up that can of worms, Sheree brought it up and said, well, Anthony, what if I went around saying what Anthony was telling me about Ralph being gay and all this other extra stuff that he's spreading around town? Drew completely does this thing where she does the same gaslighting technique that Ralph uses on her, where you glaze over what's actually happening and then focus on something else to try and deflect. She ignores the entire part where Anthony actually says that Ralph is gay. Instead, she jumps to, you're not gonna let anybody talk about your husband. If he was your husband, you're not gonna let anybody talk about your husband. Girl, did you not hear the part where your assistant, who you have in your house all the time, is telling people that your husband is gay? Are you serious? You completely missed that part. That part is not registering with you. If anything, you should say, you know what? Thank you, Sheree, for letting me know that this is what he's doing. I had no idea. The way that I approached you and brought the information to you was wrong. So now that I know, I'm sorry. Instead, she just glazed over and tried to figure out something else that she wants to deflect. Well, you wouldn't. And so Kandi's like, hold up. You do know that Anthony was the one who originated that statement talking about your husband. If you're so upset about people bringing up your husband, he started it. And she just looks so dumb. Just so dumb. Then Sheree's like, you're gonna apologize to me? She said, well, I apologize to you for putting your hand, for putting my for that, and for bringing the information to you incorrectly, because I did go to Kandi and I said, Kandi, how do I handle this, as in I wanted advice type situation, right? And Sheree said, okay. She turned her attention to Kandi and she said, Kandi, when you were supposed to be my friend, Kandi took all of 2 seconds to say, yup, I did it. And I was like, yes, Kandi girl, that's the way to take a responsibility. But Kandi issued her apology to Sheree. Sheree in her confessional does not feel like that apology was sincere. Now, the only thing about that situation with Kandi for me is that I know that Kandi would not appreciate it if people got Todd's name in their mouth. Because I know that when Phaedra was there and Phaedra was saying a whole lot of stuff and putting up in Portia's ear that his name was Marvin and he's trying to cheat on her somewhere in New York. That's why he has his own place. Talking about how the dungeon, all that stuff. She did not appreciate nobody talking about Todd. So I can see how Kandi can relate, as in I don't want anybody talking about me behind my back. Girl, you were being messy. You were. So then Marlo takes this moment to address Kandi and her, I guess, her sexpertise in her company, right? And she says, Kandi, I wish you would slow down on all the sex stuff. And Kandi was like, on her confessional, girl, you basically you this topic that we're talking about, you're used to talking about it in your old life, girl. We know who you were, type situation. And then Marlo says, you got us having all these sex toys, you got people show up in our house half naked, and now you want us to wear some panties that where people can have some remote control controlling the vibrating panties. And Kandi, her confessional, said, you must be used to that, because I know your panties been hot for a long time, so I don't know why you complaining about now. How about you have some sex? And I was just like, dang. In the middle of that, Marlo decides that she's a marriage counselor. She said, Kandi, instead of you basically giving us all the sex toys, why don't you just bust it open for Todd? Because he's complaining, saying that you're not at home doing your wifely duties. And just like you like, you're very important about your jobs. Basically, boning your husband is a job too. So why don't you go home and give him the da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You know, go ahead and let him know why he married you. Make him remember what it was about your freaky stuff that he chose to wife up, okay? Because right now, you're struggling, okay? Them legs need to be... Okay, and what we need to be hearing about is not you giving us sex toys. What we need to be hearing is, that's how that booty was sounding when he was all up in it. Todd, the entire time that she was getting this marriage counseling advice from Marlo, for all people who's not married, is quiet because he knows this is what he wants. Now, in the middle of this dinner also, Marc, I guess, calls Kandi, and I'm just sick of him. Marc is a narcissist just as much as Ralph is. I'm just sick of Marc. I don't want to hear anything about Marc. I don't want to hear that he exists. I don't want to hear anything about him, because to me, he's a bum. Okay? If, according to Kandi, you have not seen your own daughter for 3 months, right? And now that she's in town, she was considerate enough to bring your daughter into town and have an au pair bring the daughter to you after making arrangements to you that she's coming into town. You're gonna now spend some time with her, and you're gonna blow up her phone for her to come take her daughter because you want to go to work. I understand that work is important, you got to make money, but if you haven't seen her for 3 months, you can take a day off. And Kandi had to step out and take the phone call, but at this point Kandi is basically sick of Marc and everything that he comes with. She is. And I understand that part of her experience with Marc is one of the reasons why she blew up on Ralph and told Ralph that he's disrespectful and he basically treats Drew like her feelings are not substantiated. And so we're sitting here watching this entire scenario go down, knowing that Marc already asked to have some kind of rights to her house or something, even though he's not even seeing his daughter at all. I mean, come on. It almost seems like Marc is just there to take something from her. Basically, that's what it is. Anyway, then we have what else? We have Tyrone come up, the topic of Tyrone. And Sheree says that Tyrone is currently on house arrest. He has an ankle monitor and that he can't travel more than 100 miles. And that him coming to this location is about close to 100 miles, about 9.94 point something miles. It's just under the maximum of where he can travel. So it's still within the distance to where he can come and everybody can meet him. So everybody's still waiting to see this Tyrone. Okay, I'm gonna get to him later. Then we get to day two, and Ralph is now going to the gym. Todd is going to the gym with Ralph, and I'm thinking Ralph is not good company, Todd. You better be smart enough to understand that Ralph's behavior is questionable. Don't lose what you have with Kandi. Then we have Brooklyn. Topic of Brooklyn coming up with Sonya and her husband, that Brooklyn actually spent the night over there with Sonya, which lets me know that somebody ended up having to go and get Brooklyn from Marc because he apparently couldn't watch his own daughter for a night. It's crazy to me. Then we have Kandi and Sonya now taking a walk outside of their hotel, enjoying New York City, because if you guys have not been to New York City before, it's very beautiful. It's like, it's exactly what you see on TV. It looks exactly like that. There's always something to see. All the famous like stuff, you Versace, all that stuff exists in there. It looks very nice, and it's nice to walk in as far as sightseeing. A lot of people walk in New York. It's very crowded. So while they're walking, Kandi and Sonya are talking. And Sonya mentions that Ross used to play for the Super Bowl. And Kandi's like, I was wondering what he did, you know, why he was important in your life, because she was also a professional track star. And she said Ross was a football player, and it, you know, when he won that Super Bowl, okay, he also won that night as well, because that was a night of some freaky deaky. I mean, that entire game, the way he played, and then he got his first Super Bowl, whoo, that hits the clitoris a different way, okay? And you can ask him, because he definitely got some, okay? He was in there. Now... Kandi and Sonya are talking and walking, and they discuss Ralph and Drew. And they bring up how Ralph and Drew's relationship were a little bit odd. It seems a little bit immature. Ralph knows how to manipulate Drew because Drew doesn't have good critical thinking skills, like I said. She doesn't know how to analyze the situation, and that's why she keeps getting gaslit. I know that when people are held, their back is against the wall, they're either going to get defensive, or they're going to try to deflect, or they're trying to do something to distract you or to make you think that you're the problem. I've experienced that in many relationships, even my current relationship. Now, my husband has been, you know, when he does some dumb stuff and try to, as soon as I hear that, oh, but no. I literally like, no, this is not how this conversation is going to go. This is what's going to happen. I'm going to state my problem. We're going to focus on this problem, and we're not going to deviate from this problem until it's fixed. And if you cannot fix the problem, this entire house, everybody in this house, including yourself, would be widely uncomfortable until it is fixed. So do you want to fix it now, or do you want to make this house uncomfortable for you for the next 2 days? You will be eating ramen every single day for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I will not cook for you. I will not wash for you. You will get no ass, and I dare you to go outside and go and find it somewhere else. Now, do you want to gaslight me, or do you want to get to the root of this? Because we're not going to move on until this is solved. That usually gets him to kind of back off and get in his right mind, because I'm not doing that. When I'm not doing something, I'm not doing it. So we either going to fix this or we not. Then we have Tanya discussing how she's looking at Drew with a side eye, because Drew apparently has a tendency to either look confused, like she doesn't know what's going on, or she has no idea what you're discussing with her. Like, she can't comprehend the concepts that are coming out of your mouth, or she has a way of deflecting or over talking you or being overly aggressive. The same way that she experiences where Ralph treats her is how she treats everybody else. She learned from him, and she goes and reenacts it in other ways in other people's lives. In some ways, I think that they deserve each other. Like, they're just meant to be together. They don't know how to not be messy. They're just both messy, okay? Then we have them discussing Drew's fitness. Drop it with Drew. When we know that drop it with Drew, Drew dropped her pounds by going under the knife. Now, Drew has given several excuses about how she physically had to go under the knife, and there's been so many excuses. It's almost like him from Real Housewives, earlier on, where they said, where is your scooter, girl? With all the problems that you have, girl, where is your scooter? Where is your scooter? Where is it? Okay, that's how I feel at this point, because it's like every time they talk to her, she says, I have surgery. Okay. Then they asked her, but the surgery was for weight loss. She said, well, I had a mommy makeover. But then she said, no, it wasn't a mommy makeover. It's something that I had to have because I had this problem. Girl, pick a struggle, because even I'm having a hard time keeping up. Okay, pick one struggle, one, and stick to your lie, okay? Remember the lie that you tell, so when you're telling it to people, you can stick to it, so we cannot have to guess, and you're not looking, you know, a little crazy right now. So they're discussing it, and Sonya basically says that every time she talks to Drew right now, the way that Drew's moving, she can't really vibe with her and support her as a friend. And Kenya says what I said, well, at least Drew's true to form. You know, at least you know you're gonna be confused every time you ask her a question. At least she's consistently confusing, okay? Then we got Sheree, there's a scene with Sheree and then discussing Tyrone, and then her saying that Tyrone could not come to New York to be on camera and support her because he's something else is coming up, something else can't be there. And she was talking to Kandi, and Kandi was like, if it was me, sure, I want to know who's laying up under, because if he's not seeing me, who are you with? Some girl? Whose house is you with? That's what I would think since you've been behind bars this whole time. In my mind, I'm thinking, Sheree, now that Tyrone is not in cell block D roommating with the booty warrior, you know, needing some attention from the outside world, you know, having you as his pen pal, he's now in society. And generally, there is a huge percentage of people who go to prison and come out kind of crapping on the person who was supporting them while they were behind bars. Now, I'm okay with people dating people behind bars, because I found my husband when my husband has been behind bars, and when I've said it many times in my video. However, I lucked out to a certain extent. My husband was one of those people that actually wanted to get his life together. The only thing was, I didn't put mine on hold, i.e. Sheree made a huge mistake. This is what I don't advise for people. And I'm writing my book, and I'm gonna let y'all know what happened. I'm, you know, explain how scenarios went. You do not ever put your life on hold for somebody who is on hold. When people are in prison and you're trying to date them or in jail, their life is on hold. So why would you put yours on hold for them? It's a completely different environment. The outside community is how they keep their attention from going crazy. They like to have connections out there. Hell, even Ted Bundy had somebody who was talking to him behind bars while he was over there on a serial killer charge. I'm just saying, you don't want to hold your life up for somebody like that. You need to live. And then when they come out, if they're really sincere, then you can see it. I had no idea that I was going to marry my husband. I was under the impression this was a game, and I was like, let me see how it's going to go. I was still meeting people. I was still talking to people. I was still enjoying myself. I was still living life. And when he actually came out, I was the one telling him to go to his family and go do this and go do that. He was the one actively wanting to spend time with me and actively trying to do stuff with me. And the initiative he took to actually be there, I wasn't the one chasing him. Sheree is chasing Tyrone. and Tyrone is not chasing her back, and that's the problem. He's probably chasing somebody else. She's chasing him. You're the third wheel in the background. You didn't already serve your purpose by probably sending him money, sending everything. I did not send a single dime to my husband while he was behind bars. Let's be clear. I didn't send nothing. What I sent him was the books he should have been reading in high school while he was ditching Grapes of Wrath, Romeo and Juliet, Much Ado About Nothing, Hatchet, To Kill a Mockingbird. I mean, y'all remember all the good books that we used to read when we were in school, how they taught us, you know. We sat up there and read To Kill a Mockingbird and then realized all the stuff that they were saying as a black person was insane, because our teachers didn't really clarify that what we were reading was some serious racist stuff. I'm just saying, it was like watching some similar stories like Emmett Till, but To Kill a Mockingbird. I mean, heck, I'm just saying. But those are the books I sent him, including 50 Shades of Grey and another book called Candy Liquor. That book was hilarious, y'all. If you guys want to read something that's ratchet and full of juice, and read Candy Liquor by, I think her name is Noir or something, one of those black erotic authors. Yes, that was good reading. Okay, then we have, they're out to eat now after watching Candy's, they're out to eat prior to watching Candy's play. And somebody asks, Kenya asks, who's the most famous person that hit on you? Kandi said that she dated Gerard Levert and they did a song together that is still sitting there and has not been published, or has not been put out there, and that she used to date him for a hot minute. Todd was like, who do I have to beat up? That's exactly what my man would say, but it was nice to know this was a fun moment for them. But then we get to Drew. Drew said that she got a drink from a famous NBA player, and it sounded like she said LeBron, but they bleeped him out. And I'm pretty sure she said LeBron. I mean, I'm not sure. You guys can correct me if it was LeBron that they said, because the things I was hearing refers to LeBron in my mind, because Kenya and her freaking shadiness got on the confessional, on the side talk, saying, girl, she wasn't dating LeBron. She was dating Laquan. I was like, Laquan, girl. Kenya, stop it, please. And then, of course, Marlo's sitting up there like, you know she lying. But then Sonya was like, hold up. You're saying that you were dating him, because she asked, was this before he got married? She said, yeah, it was before he got married. But then we know that LeBron has been with his wife since high school. So were you the side chick, Drew? Because it looked like you were the side chick. If that was what you were talking about, you were the side chick, girl. And you just admitted on national television that you were a side chick. I'm just saying. So, and she also said something like he was listening to her music while he would play. I was like, girl, he wouldn't listen to your music while you would play. He was lying to you and telling you that he was listening to your music because he wanted to keep getting what he was getting from you, if that was the case. Because ain't no way. Drew can sing? I haven't heard her. I thought she was an actor. I'm just saying. Then we have Marlo saying that she, hers was Gene Simmons. And they show a picture of Gene Simmons. And I'm like, Marlo. We already know that you have a tendency to, you were a gold digger. I don't know if you still are, because you made all the money you need to make to start your own business to continue the flow, the money flow. But he looked like your type, according to Kenya. There's a 30-year difference. He's old. He's white. He fits the entire, probably looking for his nice chocolate queen, trying to dip into the little, you know, the sea of brownness. You know, people, there are some people, not just white people, that have a fetish where they want to know what it's like to be with people outside their races. Some people who have a fetish to want to be with white girls. There's some who want to at least try out a black person at least once. I know I met one. So Marlo was out here dating all these old white men who are probably interested in dating some black Nubian queen and giving her all the money she want. And seeing his picture, girl, he fit the mold, Marlo, for you to get what you needed. I hope you got what you needed out of him. But then we have Marlo now ask about Tyrone. And she, by Sheree, says that he couldn't make it to another yet gathering for them to meet him. It's just like he couldn't make it for the first one. He can't make it for the second one. Now, she, by Sheree, I'm like, girl, he's not for you. But let's just keep going. Then we get to the play, and they're supposed to wear their the panties that Candy got them with the remote control. They're supposed to wear it, and then they're supposed to hand the remote control out to different people, and they're supposed to push it, and you don't know who's basically tickling your clit. So they're supposed to just on the bus on the way to the play, Thoughts of a Colored Man. And of course, Kenya wasn't playing that game. Sheree said she forgot her remote, and Sonya wore her panties, but Kandi said something in the confessional saying like all the remote control can control several panties. So Sonya's sitting on the bus and suddenly her clip is buzzing. Everything is buzzing in there. It's just like making her flick a little bit. She's just like shaking. She's like, something's going on down there. I'm not in my room. I cannot jump my man like I did after he won the Super Bowl. So who's basically sitting here tickling my pinkness? And you look over there and Ralph is smiling. Of course it would be him, the little cheater. Of course it'd be you. You who's been accused of cheating, you with the assistant, is going to be you trying to now make some other woman pleasure in front of your wife. Why, man? Why is it you? Why? I mean, he's always a token person doing something dumb. Hey, I mean, you're married to her, so she'll let you probably give her some excuse later. And she'll say, it's okay, I understand, because you're misunderstood. Then we have them having to stop and walk the rest of the 7 minutes, 7 minutes down to go and see. Marlo was smart, even though her outfit was cute. Marlo's, I think she had liposuction, looks great on her. The outfit she was wearing looked amazing. Her body is so snatched. And Marlo's on the bike while everybody was walking to the spot because she can't walk. She gets there, they go watch the show, they come out, and apparently, according to what they said, it was reviewed very well. They got a wonderful, wonderful show. And Kandi lets us know that it's basically seven black men displaying different black men's experiences and what they go through. And they're all discussing it. And there's like one scene that they talked about where the guy's talking to, was it his barber or something? And he said, you know what? I want to stay here and take care of my mom. And the man's like, no, your mom is here. She'll be fine. Go find yourself and do something for yourself. We don't have to always be the struggle. We got to take care of somebody else in that way. You can go do your stuff and then come back and get her. Then Kenya said something that resonated with me. She said, what the show displayed what black men could be and what they should be, and it was all represented on stage. Kenya should be reviewing things more often, because that was a wonderful, wonderful line. It told me everything I need to know about that play. Good job, Kandi. Then we have the next scene where Sheree, Marlo, and Kenya are having a snack and they're discussing just different topics, and Drop It With Drew comes up. And everybody starts going ahead and looking up Drop It With Drew, see if they can find an app, Cash App, a Google, Wikipedia page, something to give us some information about this Drop It By Drew mystery we've been trying to learn something about. We didn't find Drop It By Drew BBL, but what we're trying to do is find Drop It By Drew, and obviously you can't find nothing. But then Kenya looked up her page, it popped up. Marlo looked up her page for her new business, and it popped up. So nobody can see anything about Drew's business. We don't even know if it exists. So here comes Drew and Ralph and all the men coming out. Kenya looks at Ralph and said, you know, I want to apologize for the way that I talked to you at the dinner the night before, because I may have been projecting. Ralph should have just taken an apology to the bank. Instead, this fool had the nerve to say, thank you for saying that, because you know sometimes I'm misunderstood. What? At that point, I was very proud of Kenya for not taking the bait, because I would have took the bait. You're misunderstood. I didn't misunderstand nothing. You really are out of your mind. You're a narcissist. I was just apologizing to you because you ain't my man. I'm just saying. But then we have all the men decide to leave. And you have Sonya deciding that this is the moment that she wants to address Drew about what she's been discussing with Kenya about Drew's little ways and how she's been doing things wrong when it comes to how she handled Anthony's messiness with Sheree. She brings it up. And Drew, true to form, I'm confused. I don't know what you're talking about. Like, what? Girl, what? I mean, I don't get it. I don't understand what's going on. And then here's the next thing she does, is deflect. Sonya's like, you know, let me explain it to you because you're about to get it. Is that I know that you want me to support you as a friend. We've had several conversations, but I want you to understand that I can't support something that I don't believe in. I can't support something that you're doing that doesn't seem right. And Drew's like, what? What are you talking about? I just... What, girl? Like, do you? I'm so confused, because you were just in my room, and you were there. You could have talked to me there, but we were just on the phone, girl. Deflecting. She's ignoring the point of what she's trying to say now and talk about something else. Even though Sonya could have done this in a different scene off camera, she chose this moment. But Drew's, again, not really trying to pay attention to the point of it. She's just like, you know, what are you talking about? Because we were just in the car. I just picked you up, and we were just in the car. You could have brought this up. Sonya's like, she goes with an entourage. She always got a lot of people around her. And then the producers actually showed all the people that are around Drew when she's by herself. She's not really by herself, but still, Drew, of course, doesn't want to address the Sheree thing again, because Sonya actually said, you know, like with the Sheree thing, I didn't rock with it. She goes, what? Like, I just don't get what's happening right now, because you had opportunities to talk to me and you didn't. So I just don't know why you would have it now between the groups. So deflect, confused as usual. She always confused. Girl, stay confused, because we're going to ask you about your business now. So they bring up the business and they ask Drew,
about her business. Why you have a weight loss business when you are, had a weight loss surgery? Because Sheree gets up and says, weight loss is my business and my body tells it all, which she does work out. You guys see her on her Instagram. She has several workout things that she's shown us. Kenya, we know, works out too. Phaedra, we thought was working out with her donkey booty, but we still see that she, that donkey is still big as heck and she wasn't working nothing but the bank. So we're not sitting here listening to Drew. Drew says, you know what? I had fat weight. I had weight loss surgery because I had no choice, because I had a hernia and I had something else and I had this and I had that. And I'm just like, girl, stop talking. Then they say, okay, well, what does this do? Because we, you know, I was trying to, Sheree was like, I was trying to sign up and we couldn't find it. She skipped the whole we couldn't find it part and was like, oh, thank you. Oh, Drew is like a blonde, okay? Like, I'm sorry, but she's... I can't. Like, it's just the way that she... The same deflection that Ralph does, I don't think that she understands that she's mastered it as well. So Marlo's asking her, okay, can you explain to us what this does? What does it do? Keep it 100 with us, because you shouldn't call it Drew... you shouldn't be calling drop it with Drew. You should call it 100 with Drew. We need you to be 100 for once in your life. And I'm just like, Marlo. Everybody's laughing at it. She goes, well, we have fat loss camps. We have meal plans. We have three-week challenges. We have everything that you can think of. And we make a lot of money from it. Kenya's like, this is Facebook group, girl. This is not a real, this is a Facebook group. You guys have like, you know, a little, this is like a little chat room that you guys have to motivate each other. And you guys just come up with all these different things to do. And somebody said, no, Marlo says it's a Facebook group. Kenya said it's a Ponzi scheme. And then as they're talking about it, Drew says, y'all want to see how much money I make from it? Sheree goes, yes, we do. And then the producers, as Messi said, well, how much money do you make? Drew gets on the phone and calls somebody and says, girl, I need you to be on the phone with me because you handle all the money stuff. Girl, you don't know how much money you make from your business. I don't think Drew can help herself. I just don't see her. I just think that she gets herself just deeper and deeper, deeper into the hole, giving Andy all the ammunition to get at her during the reunion that comes up from the season. I'm just sorry. She's going to get it from everybody. Then we have Tyrone calling Sheree while they're in this meeting. And while Sonya is looking at, is trying to still make her own, have her moment with Drew, because she's like, are you okay? She goes, no, I'm not. And she's smiling and everybody's ignoring her. Kenya's talking to Tyrone, said, we can't wait to see you. And they show Tyrone's face in the camera. I don't know if it's the camera phone or if that's what he really looks like, but he is not attractive at all. Then I look back at you know, Sheree's previous men that she dated. Sheree's a very beautiful woman, but I don't think that she has a good self-esteem. The man that she had kids with, you know, when he came on that show, that big old dude with an eye that just looks like one is going in separate ways, that had the nerve to say that he was actually abusive to her. He was abusing her when she was, when they were actually dating, trying to get up in that house, doing everything he can to get up now that his retirement didn't expire. He's not making football money. And I thought that Sheree was with him because of his football, you know, money. Turns out he was, you know, he was funny. But he was also very disrespectful and he went too far. And nothing is a joke. He was just going too far. We don't want to see his face because he just admitted that he was abusing her when they were married. That was the first introduction of who she's been with. Sticking his tongue out when during the court case that Phaedra lost. You see him because he won the court case. Phaedra wasn't prepared and he was like walking like a dumbass. Then we have the next guy that Sheree had, she was dating, was the guy who was got his. He said that he was a counselor. He was a doctor. He said he was a doctor and they asked him where he got his doctorate from because nobody could prove that he was a doctor. And this fool said he got it online. This is when before we realized that there's a lot of online schools that we're still trying to get Biden to give us our loans, our some of the loans back that we took for these schools that just kind of took advantage of us and stuff like that. So he says that he's got his doctorate degree online. I don't want a doctor to do anything with me that had got his degree online. I'm sorry. There are certain professions that you just can't get your degree online. Can you come with me and say, I'm a surgeon, but I got my degree online and my license online so I can operate on you. What? So that was her second introduction to for us seeing the kind of guys that Sheree dates. Then we have Tyrone. Sheree has not shown a pattern of picking good people to be in her life. I don't even think she has the right radar for one. She seems like she's ready for love and she wants love in her life, but she's not picking the right one. For some reason, that's the case. Because not only is she not picking the right one, she's not picking ones that are actually is attractive enough to be with her to the level of attraction that she is. She is now finding love with Tyrone. And Tyrone sitting up here on the screen saying, yeah, I can't wait to see you. I can't wait to meet everybody. All this nonsense that he's spewing, basically fake nutting her, telling her whatever she needs to hear to basically ask for some money. He probably asked for money to even come to the next scene. scene that we see Sheree going to meet him for, because he probably broke. Then we have the next scene. Okay, the next day, Sheree is now preparing to get herself to Philly. Now that Tyrone couldn't come to New York, she's now going to have to sit in a car for an hour and 40 minutes before heading back from New York to Atlanta. They flash back to all the scenes that they have with her when she was talking to Tyrone all those years back. Tyrone, she says she has no fears, that he's her soulmate, he's everything to her. Basically everything that a lot of people who are talking to somebody behind bars feels, because they tell you whatever you want to hear. Y'all build this strong connection over the phone. They do whatever it is to get into your pockets. And then when they come out in real life, all that stuff that they were telling, all that la 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 that they were dreaming in, it doesn't exist. If you think I'm wrong, watch Love After Lockup. You'll find you get a whole lot of mess of what happens with a lot of them. Does it happen all the time? No. But another for you to pick the right one. And people might say, oh my gosh, why on earth would you date somebody in prison when you got all these men out here? Well, a third of black men are behind bars. And a lot of them are behind bars for some dumb stuff, because this law, we already know, is not fair based on race. There are a lot of black and brown people behind bars for things that a lot of people who are not black and brown were released for. And did nobody care about the crack epidemic until it started happening to other groups of people? Nobody cares until it starts happening to a different group of people. So to say that people who are behind bars are off limits entirely is false. There are people there who were there for shoplifting multiple times. Okay, it's called robbery because they were broke. There are people there who were caught selling marijuana that's now legal in certain states. There are people there that may have been caught on the street for hoeing, trying to get cash. It didn't hurt nobody. We were just hoeing. So there are people who have all those charges, and there are some people that have charges, sex offender charges, when they're 19, dating somebody that's 17 years old. There are different people that were behind bars for dumb stuff that have a felony charge. Now, of course, there are people who deserve to be there. We got murderers still out there. Okay, we got people who kill people. We got manslaughter still out there. We have several other reasons that somebody deserves to be behind bars. But we know that in this country, we have white collar crimes. The people who are behind bars for money laundering or for, you know, credit card fraud or for something like that. But we already know that there's a lot of stuff that's already been stole from a legal way. We pay our taxes every year, and some of the money we don't know where it's going. So it's not in our pockets. It's going to a lot of the people that we chose up there, their pockets. I'm just saying. So that's just stealing in the right way. So I'm not gonna now write off that somebody having a felony is a huge deal as far as dating goes. You're gonna have problems when it comes to finding certain types of employment. Yes, but as far as dating, you have to figure it out what you're willing to do. I'm just saying, it's a risk, but you got to figure out what you're willing to do. Sheree, however, chose to date Tyrone. People were telling her that she's crazy, is she desperate? I don't know. She chose to put herself in this situation. However, I don't think that she should have dived in to the extent that she spent years waiting for this man to come out and make her look foolish, because she now drives somewhere an hour and 40 minutes, okay? She's waiting at this outside cafe looking thing. She's looking beautiful. She's looking cute. She wants to see her man. 30 minutes go by, and the waitress is coming here. It's cold outside, giving her whatever she needs to stay warm, hot cocoa, whatever. He's not there. An hour goes by, he's not there. An hour and 30 minutes goes by, he's still not there. Sheree now calls her daughter to talk to her daughter about, yo, you know, I've been waiting out here, and Tyrone's not here. What does it mean when you're calling somebody and they just keeps going straight to voicemail or it starts beeping? What does it mean? Her daughter said, it means you're blocked. And she's like, what? I just talked to him this morning. Then producers come up and say, yo, we're on the phone with Tyrone's lawyer, and he said that he cannot come here because it's a parole violation. And Sheree just outs him. We've been going to dinner and lunch this whole time. We've been going out. I don't understand why he can't go on camera. Well, Sheree, I don't know what Tyrone is doing. I don't know if it's just this is the game he's playing. I'm not sure yet. I still need it to play out throughout the season and hear everything in detail. But, girl, if he was going to lunch with you all this time, off camera, and he's saying now that his lawyer is saying that it's not right, that means that he was violating his parole on the low, and that you weren't supposed to out him, and that put him on camera now to have him being seen when he's on house arrest. Girl, that's not the case. You should have just taken the camera with you to his house so you can see what's going on, if there's a female there too, so we can get the real answers that we need. This whole Love After Lockup part two that we're going on in Real Housewives reality. We have a reality TV show going on inside a reality TV show. That's what we're seeing. So we need to just see the whole picture. But poor Sheree can't reach Tyrone. Tyrone didn't bother to borrow somebody's phone to tell his baby and his boo that he can't make it. He didn't say nothing. He just blocked her, not even answering her call. This particular scene was funny because of the title, She By Herself, because she really was by herself. But it was also touching because we know how Kenya and Sheree's relationship first began. It was tumultuous. They were making fun of each other's houses, even though both houses look absolutely beautiful now. But it's ironic that the person that Sheree calls for support in this part where she's genuinely trying to hold it together emotionally is Kenya, and Kenya handled it superb, okay? Now, I talk about all the housewives. I'm not biased. I will read whoever I need to read depending on which the situation is. I will talk about you. I don't care. And when Kenya needs to be read, some of you Kenya fans just have to sit there and just let her be read, okay? But in this particular situation, when she deserves some kudos, I'm going to give her one, because Kenya said all the right things to Sheree. She said, you know, there's things that he's showing you about himself. Just dock it down, but you're still beautiful. Don't cry, baby. Do you want me to help you look for a flight to help you back? Walk through that airport. Keep your head up high. You're still beautiful. You know what you are. You know the type of person that you are and stuff like that. And Kenya made a huge point earlier in the show. Kenya has some wisdom and it shows. She said something in the beginning of the episode where she said, when they said, you know, if Mark doesn't want to see her, Mark doesn't want to see Brooklyn, why are you chasing him down? Why are you making him do it? Let him come to you. Kenya said, no, I have to do this for my daughter, because daughters need their fathers in their life because they help their self-esteem. And those are facts. Because I've lived with girls that don't have, who didn't have fathers in their life. One of them got bamboozled by an Israelite, or somebody who self-proclaimed Israelite, that just ended up being crazy. They try to convince her into having plural wives, try to convince her into not going to the hospital when she was pregnant with their baby, not having proper medical care, and treated her badly because she had to have a C-section, saying that she didn't trust the Most High. Doesn't want any of the women talking to him or asking him questions. Wants to be the new Jim Jones and create this land where he has all these people come to him and he's a prophet. This fool had the nerve to say, I want 11 boys and a daughter like the Israelite Jacob in the Bible, because that's what God told me, I'm a prophet. This is the foolishness I talk about. She didn't have a father in her life because her father was on drugs, unfortunately. And so she was able to be played by this guy because he tried to come to me with that bull. You need to humble yourself. The Bible says humble yourself. So it's okay for a man to have multiple wives because you as a wife has to humble yourself. I said, huh? I said, I know what it says in the Bible, child. I know that there were plural wives in the Bible, but that time did not have as many people in this society as it did back then. They needed to populate. Now that we have a lot of people, I can find a lot of men everywhere. Monogamy is not something that's far-fetched. I don't need to be with a man who is wanting me to share him with multiple wives, i.e. you're not gonna be in my bed every night. So for two nights I have you, and two nights she has you, and two nights she has you. What if they go sleep with somebody else? You gonna come back and share that disease with me? Heck no. First of all, I want you in my bed whether we're doing it or not. I'm not used to sleeping by myself. I need somebody to cuddle with. And no, I'm not gonna humble myself in that regard. What kind of nonsense is that? I want you to share me with other women, but you need to humble yourself to do so. What? I want you to share me with other men. You need to humble yourself to do so. How about that? That's so, but she got bamboozled by him. She married him spiritual way. And unfortunately, now they have a son and they're divorced. But I do know that part of it is because she didn't have a dad in her life. Because when he was telling me that crap, I was looking at him. And when I told my father just died of laughter, like, because he knows I wasn't going to fall for that bull. But I'm saying Kenya is right. When a female is not used to having a father in her life, there is some damage that is done. There's a certain stage in life where a girl needs a father to tell her the real. All these girls that this guy is dating, trying to screw at 21, 22 years, so he ain't gonna marry her. You don't wanna be one of those girls that he's playing around with, he's gonna cheat on. You need to catch him when he's like 30, when he's not in his right mind. So when Sheree is sitting here crying for the third time on TV, having picked a wrong guy again, it begs the question, what was her example of men? Because now it's just becoming where she looks crazy. And she said she looked crazy. And poor Sheree just sat up there. And I'm like, girl, just focus on She by Sheree. Get that going. Because the relationship for you ain't it. Not on this show. So far, this is a third strike for you. And I'm sorry. But, you know, it was hard to watch. But, you know, it is what it is. This episode was very, very good. It had a good amount of shade and a good amount of insight. I was very happy to watch it. I was enthused. Okay, I was very happy to review it. Look out for the Real Housewives of Dubai. I posted the first one. Go ahead and check it out. I'm going to be reviewing Real Housewives of Dubai. I'm considering reviewing Real Housewives of Beverly Hills as well, but I haven't watched all the other seasons. I'm just starting in this season. So Erica and I'm still pondering if I want to go ahead and review that, but you'll find out if I do when you see the review. I'm going to go ahead and watch Basketball Wives when it comes out. I'm going to go ahead and do it. So go ahead and check those out too. You guys have a good evening. Have a good rest of your day or night. Bye.